Well, thank you so much for joining us for another daily devotion today. And as we continue to be locked in and we go through and rummage through our house and find out different things that maybe we want to keep, maybe we want to throw away, and there's certain things that I'm going to hold on to. And one of those things that I want to share with you today is just an incredible reminder of a person who had a great influence on my life, a great impact on my life, and really impacted my life to see the beauty and the sovereignty of God throughout history, but also the impact that we have and the opportunities that we have, and that we may never miss an opportunity. And so when I was rummaging through the house, I found this, and it's a copy of the Florala, the paper at the University of North Alabama, and the title simply says on the front page, Remembering a Mentor. And I want to show you, it's a memorial of Dr. Larry Nelson. Now, when I first moved from Eastern Kentucky to go to school at University of North Alabama in Florence, there were many people that had an impact on my life and made that possible. Many people associated with the church at Woodmont Baptist Church. But one of the things I kept hearing as I registered for classes and signed up for classes is, oh, I hope you get to take Dr. Nelson. I hope you need to take Dr. Nelson. Dr. Nelson is one of the greatest teachers. He's the greatest professor. He teaches history. You got to take Dr. Nelson. And so when I went to register for classes, there was a history class that was offered on Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 8 o'clock in the morning. And so I signed up for this. Now the teacher listed in that book that had all the classes listed, the instructor for that class was simply listed as staff, meaning that I didn't know who the teacher was. And so I remember scared to death. It was my first class at UNA, 8 o'clock in the morning on a Wednesday morning. I walked into the top level, top floor, third floor of Bibb Graves Hall, and I walk in and I sit down, and I'm sitting there. I do not know what to expect. I don't know what college is going to be like. I have all these fears and just this trepidation about what it is going to be like and what this instructor is going to be like. And I remember this tall professor coming in and walking in, and he sits down and he starts teaching, and then he stands up. He becomes very animated and he starts talking about the invasion of the body snatchers. And I have no idea what he's talking about, but I remember sitting there going, I don't think this is Dr. Nelson. I don't know who this is, but the invasion of the body snatchers, I don't know who that is. And what this class is going to be like, but it was so entertaining and riveting. And I remember he just got us thinking. And then I found out that it was Dr. Nelson. And over the next 4 years, as I went through college, I took him for numerous classes. And if you've taken a class under Dr. Nelson, you know what an incredible man of faith he was. But you also know what a gifted communicator and teacher he was. I remember I would sit there and think, he's teaching U.S. history with no notes. Like, he's up there just talking about these dates and these times and these people, and he just has it all memorized, and it's incredible. And one of the phrases that he kept coming back to was this: good history is intellectual history. Meaning this, that in order to understand history, you had to understand why and the reasons behind the motivations that people had to do what they did in history. And as you study that, you begin to realize the significance of what people were doing and the significance of those moments so much more than just memorizing dates and names and people. And so what I learned so much during those semesters when I would just sit under his teaching, and I remember I learned so much in his constitutional law class and constitutional history of the United States class. And I remember all of these classes and all of these conversations and how his office was always open, how he was such an influence to the sororities and to the fraternities and the Greek life. And I remember after he passed away, I even had the opportunity to speak at a sorority's Bible study that he led. And I'm sure I did a pitiful job, but I was so honored just to be asked to have an opportunity like that, to follow in his footsteps. And I remember in his class, he would talk about that. Good history is intellectual history. And it's so important to remember the significance behind the situations and what was motivating people to act the way they did. And can I tell you something? That's one of the reasons that I'm a Christian today. Is that when I look at the Bible and I study about the intellectual history, why did the disciples, why did the early church act in ways that it acted? And it all comes back to the resurrection of Jesus. I struggled with my faith and with the church, and why would I want to be a part of the church, and why would I want to be a part of Christianity as I was growing up? And I had some bad experiences with church leaders, with my dad being a pastor. It was all just really, really complicated. And coming back to good history, his intellectual history, led me to this, that the resurrection of Jesus has to be true. Why else would the disciples risk their life and continue to hold to the truth that the resurrection had to happen unless it really did? Why would they face death? Why would they face martyrdom? Why would they rejoice because they had been counted worthy of suffering for the name if it had not been true? Another thing that I realized is, why would the early church, as early as 20 years removed from the death of Christ, why would they celebrate his death? Why would they commemorate that by drinking wine as if it were his blood or the symbol of his blood? Why would they eat bread and say this was the body of Christ or the symbol of the body of Christ? Why would they celebrate his death or call it Good Friday unless he had risen from the dead? Why would the worship service of that day be moved from Saturday, which had been the Sabbath? And you all know how long it takes churches to change and to move toward new things. And then suddenly, Sunday becomes the Lord's Day. And they celebrate that by gathering together and worshiping on Sunday because of the day of the resurrection. Why would Paul go from persecuting the church, known as Saul, why would he go from persecuting the church and hunting down Christians to suddenly being one of the leaders of the church, building it up and writing so much of the New Testament in letters to encourage the church in the gospel, and for he himself to endure and persevere under such persecutions unless he had seen Jesus, the risen Jesus, face to face? You know, in Dr. Nelson's class, we also had something else, and that was called a Blue Book Examination. Here's one of mine from his class, and I look back through this and think about the examination and the test, and he wanted to make sure that you knew the material, and not that you knew the dates and the people, not just that, but that you knew the significance of what had happened. You know, it's a reminder to us, there's a lot of people that know about Jesus. They know about his life. They know about his doings. They know those kind of things. But they don't know the significance. They don't know him. I would encourage you today. I would remind you that an examination is coming. The test is coming of your faith. And one day we'll stand before the Lord, and we will either be judged as sheep or goats. We'll be separated. And either that we did and we believed in Jesus with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our efforts and our works reflected the salvation that was a part of our life, or we rejected him. The test is coming. I pray that you would be impacted by Jesus Christ, that you would surrender your life to him and to Dr. Nelson, to his family, to his sweet wife. I'm grateful, and I'm always indebted to Dr. Nelson. Thank you.